morning's scripture will be taken from the book of Luke. The chapter there is 8, and the verses are 44 and 45. Again, it's the book of Luke. The chapter is 8, and the verses are 44 and 45. And the Bible reads, "Came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood stanched. And Jesus said, Who touched me? When all denied, Peter said, They that were with him said, Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me?" I read Luke chapter 8, verses 44 and 45. Let us bow as we go together in prayer by Brother Tyree Baker.
Father, thank you for the gospel of your Son Jesus and the gift of the Holy Spirit who indwells in us. Help us to live the gospel and to reveal the resurrecting power of Jesus in every trial that we face today. Father, one day we know that we will stand before you and give an account of our lives. Help us to do our best for you, so that we will hear the words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Please help us stay faithful in the midst of the challenges in this life. Father, please keep watch over our leaders and our congregation here at Newburgh. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You love the Lord, say amen.
Amen.
You're glad to be here, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It's good to be here this morning. It's good to be able to lift up our voices and praise unto the God that we serve. We serve a God who's worthy to be praised. No matter what we go through or what we come from, God is still worthy of our praise. That's why we're here this morning, to worship Him. Am I right? We just want to worship the Lord. We want to thank Him for His goodness, for His gracious kindness that He has so richly given us each and every day of our life. If ever time men need to worship God, it is today. The day of the Lord and the day the Lord has made. And we are so glad therein. So we're just thankful to God for your presence here this morning. If you are visiting with us this morning, you are our honored and distinguished guest. I want you to know that if you're here for the very first time, we welcome you with open arms. I want you to know that you are welcome here, and if there's any question that you may have concerning our worship of how we serve God or anything that we do in worship, I want you to ask freely your questions, and we may be able to serve you and give you Bible answers for why we do what we do.
Amen.
And so we just thank you for joining us today. We have with us this morning a young man that I'm becoming familiar with as the years go on. A young man, they tell me, came from my loins. And a young man that emulates me and walks with me, and just one that I'm very proud of, and glad to introduce him this morning as my son, my eldest son, Kenneth Eugene Fleming Jr. So I appreciate him, his lovely wife Denise Fleming. Stand, Denise. Glad to have her here. Amen. My son came to Louisville in 1991 or 92 to visit me, and left with a wife. So I don't know how that worked, but it worked. And so we're glad to have her in our family, my daughter. I just love her to death. And my grandchildren, they are not here, but we love them all. I'm not going to say anything else. He can introduce himself, but I'm glad he's here with us from the Waverly Church, Richland Avenue Church of Christ in Waverly, Tennessee. He's been the minister there now for about 5 years. Is that right? Going on 4. Okay, so I'm a little ahead of time. So we've been there about 4 years. But he's here with us. We're going to give way to him that he may bring the word of God to us in his own way. We're going to ask Brother Edison to give us a verse or two of another song. And the next voice you will hear will be that of Minister Evangelist Kenneth E. Fleming, Jr. from the Richland Avenue Congregation in Waverly, Tennessee.
It is once again that God has blessed each and every one of us to rise out of our beds of slumber, to be able to dress our bodies, and to have the right exercise of our minds and our limbs, that we might be able to come to the house of worship as God's people, to give him the honor and glory that he is rightly and justly deserving of. Where will we be this morning without the goodness of God? What kind of shape would we be in without the goodness of God? What mess would we be in right now without God's goodness? What situations would we find ourselves still stuck in without God's goodness? What kind of hope would we have? What kind of outlook for the future would we have right now? What good would it be to live and to go about our daily walk of life knowing that we were without God? As the song says, because he lives and because he exists, I'm able to face all of my tomorrows. Church, we serve a good God. God who is far better to us than certainly we've ever been to him, and that we could ever possibly be to ourselves. We are delighted to be among you this morning, and it's always good to be in the great city of Louisville. It's always good to be with the Newburgh congregation, to your wonderful minister and Brother Fleming Sr., and to his associate minister, Brother Wise, and to your leadership here and all the members. We're just delighted to be with you on today. And we want to say that we pray that 2017 will bring you all of the wonderful blessings that God has for each and every one of us. I want to say this past October, we had a wonderful time at the Richland Avenue congregation. The person of Brother Dwayne Wise and his lovely wife, Sister Betty, and his father, as well as Zion, and I believe Michaela came as well. Is that right? Had a wonderful time. And he brought an awesome word from the Lord. And they're still talking about it, Brother Wise. And don't be surprised if you get your few phone calls here shortly. But we had a wonderful time, and we're just delighted to have them come down and to give the country of Tennessee just a little taste of the big city of Louisville. Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. And starting at verse number 43 and concluding at verse number 48. Now, if you go to Matthew chapter 9, verses 20 and 22, as well as Mark chapter 5, verses 25 through 34, you'll find the same accounting of this incident. We find in verse 43 of Luke chapter 8, and a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which has spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any. When you look at the other accounts of this story, the Bible says that the more money she spent, that she didn't get better, but in fact, she actually got worse. And in fact, the Bible goes on and says in the other accounts that the physicians actually took advantage of this woman. But the Bible says in verse 44 of Luke chapter 8, that she came behind Jesus. She had heard that Jesus was going to be in town. And as Jesus came, that she came behind him. Another account says that she made her way through the crowd in order to get to Jesus. And she said within herself that if she could just only touch the hem of his garment, that she would be made whole. Luke's account says that she came behind Jesus and she touched the border or the hem of his garment. And the Bible says immediately. Aren't you glad we serve a Lord who works in the immediate? The Bible says that immediately her issue of blood was stanched, or it dried up. Verse 45, and Jesus said, "Who touched me?" When all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, now watch what they said to Jesus, "Master, the multitude, the crowd throngs you," or they are around you, "and they are pressing up against you, and sayest thou, who touched me?" Now understand now, this question that they asked to Jesus, it was somewhat indignant. They were being somewhat sarcastic. Now, you're the Son of God. You're the one who made the lame man walk. You're the one who caused the blind to see. It was you who raised Lazarus from the dead. You're the one who turned the water into wine. You're the one that drove the legion out of the man. You are the one who healed blind Bartimaeus. And yet you have the nerve, you have the audacity to ask us who touched you. Notice what Jesus says in verse 46. He said, somebody had touched me, for I perceive that virtue or the power is gone out of me. And when the woman saw that she was not healed, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him and how she was healed immediately. And he said unto her, daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith had made thee whole, go in peace. This is a wonderful story of faith. It is a wonderful story of perseverance. It is a wonderful story of conviction. It shows us the lengths that a person will go to. It shows the obstacles that an individual is willing to overcome in order to get to Jesus. But I want us to realize this morning, and I believe that something even more significant happens in this incident. And it's not so much the fact that this woman's issue of blood dried up. It's not even the fact that she had been taken advantage of, that she had spent all of her money, that she had been mistreated by these physicians. I believe this morning that something even more significant happens in this incident. And it boils down to a question that was asked by Jesus himself. Notice what he asked. When the woman touched the border of his garment, Jesus asked, "Who touched me?" You see, I don't believe that we can really appreciate what happened to this woman until we understand. understand the question that was asked by Jesus. And the question was, who touched me? In our world today, touching, it is an act that seems to be so simple, but it is something that carries a lot of significance. Do you not know, in my time in the military, Garrick, I had the privilege of going to various countries and seeing how other cultures interact with one another. And one of the interesting things that I found out, Garrick, is that in some countries, touching someone in public, it is considered to be offensive. To touch someone in public in other cultures, it is a sign of disrespect. It is something that is frowned upon. It is something that is looked at with great disdain. Now, you can do it in private in your own home. But to touch someone in public, it has a way of unnerving people in certain cultures. When we think about the act of touching, touching has a way of bringing people together. It is through touching that we are able to convey compassion. You can find out how compassionate folk are through touching. Did you not know that? You can also find out how tender-hearted an individual can be simply by the act of touching. It is through touching that we are able to receive healing and comfort from another individual. It is through the act of touching that we're able to convey love and affection. It is through touching that the bonds of friendship continues to manifest itself. It is through the act of touching that relationships are cemented and solidified. But I want us to realize that touching even has a way of causing people to withdraw from one another. Touching even has a way of driving us away from each other. You know, I don't know about you, but there have been times in my life I've been touched by other individuals and I had no idea who they were. And so I started looking. I'm like, why did you touch me? I don't know you. I had no dealings with you, so what would make you touch me? We've all done that. We have been touched by other people, and it had a way of making us feel uncomfortable. We didn't like it. We didn't ask for it. We didn't approve of it. And as a result, it caused us a great deal of agitation. But it goes back to the question that Jesus asked. He asked, who touched me? Why would the Son of God ask this question? What is the significance of Jesus asking, who touched me? I want to share a thought with you for just a few moments. Who touched me? You see, I believe this morning that there is someone here in this audience. Maybe you're going through something. Maybe you're dealing with adversity. Maybe you're going through struggles in your life. Maybe you're weighted down by a heavy burden. And you're looking for some kind of relief. You're looking for something this morning that might make a difference in your life. Might I suggest you might want to touch Jesus this morning? You see, Brother Marables, it's one thing to feel Jesus. It's one thing to want to worship Jesus and to want to be where Jesus is, but it's another thing entirely to reach out and touch Jesus. And I believe this morning that if you want to turn things around in your life, if you want to solidify and cement your relationship with Christ, might I suggest you be like this woman and you touch Jesus? I want to share three observations as to why Jesus asked this question. First, I want us to realize that Jesus asked this question because he realized and he knew that there was someone who was willing to extend themselves. Extending means to reach out. It means to make progress or to lunge forward. It means to make a movement which is designed to go farther than where you started from. Notice what the Bible says. She came up behind Jesus and she reached out and touched the hem of his garment, and the Bible says that immediately her blood dried up. This woman had enough faith, she had enough conviction, she had enough courage to extend herself in order to touch Jesus. And I will submit to you this morning that the reason sometimes that we remain stuck in the same position, stuck in the same predicament, stuck in the same mindset, stuck in the same old way of thinking is because we are unwilling to extend ourselves. You see, if you want Jesus to make a difference in your life this morning, you got to be willing to extend yourself. Notice what this woman did. When she heard of Jesus, when she heard that Jesus was going to be where she was, she made her way, she maneuvered through the crowd. Now keep in mind, this woman done spent all of her money. Doctors had taken advantage of her. And the Bible says that from a physical perspective, her condition continued to deteriorate. She could have very easily said to herself that enough is enough. It would have been understandable, Brother Fleming, if this woman would have said to herself, I'm tired of being tired. It would have been reasonable, Dexter, for this woman to come to the conclusion that she has stood at the edge of the cliff. It would have been reasonable for us to realize that this woman, she had gone as far as she possibly could. But the Bible says she reached out and touched the hem of his garment. She was willing to extend herself beyond her situation. She was willing to extend herself beyond her circumstances. She was willing to extend herself beyond all of her past pain. A lot of us have past pain. She was even willing to extend herself. She was willing to extend past her problems. All of us have problems. She was even willing to extend herself beyond all of her past failures. We've all had past failures. But this woman, She had enough faith and conviction. She had enough spiritual wisdom to realize that if I'm going to change anything in my life, I've got to be willing to extend myself beyond where I am and get to Jesus. How many times have you kept getting the same old results? Because you kept doing the same old thing, the same old way. It is because of our unwillingness to look beyond the present condition, to look beyond our situation, to look beyond what's going on right now in my life, and extend myself in order to get to Jesus. When was the last time you extended yourself in order to get to Jesus? Notice now, Jesus did not extend himself to the woman. The woman extended herself to Jesus. Sometimes we have to be willing to take the initiative and extend ourselves in order to get to Jesus. Sometimes we waste so much time waiting for something to happen instead of extending ourselves in order to make something happen. This woman said, I am tired of being in the shape that I'm in. Even though I've had past pain, even though I've had problems, even though I've had previous failures, it is time for me to extend beyond my present condition. And if you want to change things in your life this morning, if you really want to know what it is to have connection to Jesus, you got to be willing to extend yourselves. Go beyond your present condition. Be willing to look forward. Be willing to progress forward in your life. Make up in your mind, I'm not going to wait for everything and for everybody and for Jesus to come to me, but I'm going to reach out to him. Sometimes the Lord wants us to reach out to him. It's not that he doesn't want to extend a hand out to us. Sometimes he wants us to reach out to him. Isn't it amazing how we will extend ourselves for each other, for other people, even though sometimes they really don't have our best interests at heart? Think about how many times you've extended yourself and you've given your last dime to somebody. Think about how you've extended yourself, sometimes for your own children, even though sometimes they may not be grateful for what you do. We extend ourselves for people who we know don't care about us. We extend ourselves for people who we know going to talk about us. But yet, when it comes to the one who is able to make all things well in our life, being Jesus Christ, we're not willing to extend ourselves for him. So you got to be willing to extend yourself. I also believe that Jesus knew that there was somebody in that crowd who had an earnest expectation that something wonderful was about to happen in their life. When you look at the other accountings of this text, the Bible said that she had said to herself, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. This woman had an expectation that if I simply touch, I ain't got to Facebook him. Don't have to send him a tweet, Brother Bill. Don't have to hook up with him on Snapchat. If I can just extend myself far enough where I can touch the hem of his garment. I've got an expectation that something wonderful is going to happen to me. You know what our problem is sometimes? Not only as human beings, but even more so as Christians. Jesus can't make a difference in our lives because we don't have any expectations. You have to have an expectation that if I get to Jesus, it is going to result in something wonderful happening in my life. In everything that we do as Christians, everything that we do as children of God, everything we do as the Lord's church, we ought to do it with an earnest expectation that if we do it and have faith in the Lord, something wonderful gonna happen. You know the reason why sometimes we come to worship Sunday after Sunday and we leave just as empty as when we walk in? It ain't got nothing to do with Garrick singing. It ain't have nothing to do with the brother who read the scripture. Didn't have nothing to do with the Bible school teacher. We use other folk as scapegoat. But the real reason is we came to worship, but we had no expectations of what was going to happen when we got here. No expectation whatsoever. Every time you come to worship, you ought to come with the idea of expecting something good and wonderful happening when you get here. Your expectation ought to be to such a degree you can't wait to bust them doors down. Now, sometimes I have to get on my folk down in Waverly. Because, see, I got a few, not a whole lot, but I got a few. And I can tell that they don't have any expectations. They'll come one Sunday. Might not see them for three or four more Sundays. But yet, when they come, they act like they done you a favor. Amen. Amen. Not realizing that because of their lack of expectation, they themselves have cheated themselves out of their blessings. Let me tell you. I used to get all bent out of shape when folk wouldn't come to the worship. I would lose sleep. I would start questioning, did I not say something right? Did I not do that? But what I've learned is not you. It's not the song leader. It's not the Bible school teacher. You're dealing with somebody who has no expectations. And what I've learned, and I ain't preached as long as you have, but what I've learned is that expectation is not something you can instill in somebody else. You got to have it for yourself. The reason sometimes why we sing and yet the songs have no meaning to us, amen, it's not because you ain't on the right note or the song leader missed a note. It's because you sang it with no expectations. Now, when we get out there and we start singing, now, I'm a little old now, so y'all just have to pardon me on some of these names now. But when we start listening to Run DMC and LL Cool J, and that just show you how far behind I am. That's all right. But you know what I'm talking about. We listen to all that nonsense. I know because I used to do it. Got a big speakers in the back of the trunk, Dexter. Riding down John A. Merritt Boulevard to TSU. I'm just saying, yeah, Get in the Lord's church and we sing with no expectations. That's why the songs have no meaning to us. We opening our mouth. Words are coming out. But the song itself, it has no meaning. When we give, sometimes we give with no expectations. Brother J.B. said a little while ago, Brother J.B. Sweat said a little while ago, he said, this congregation, in terms of, I guess, your financial perspective, that y'all are in good shape. Praise be to God. But it would not have happened unless somebody had some expectations. When you give, you got to have expectations. That when I give based on what the Lord has done for me, I have an expectation that if I give as God has prospered me, good things are going to happen to me. Now, that don't mean you're going to have a four-bedroom house and a four-car garage, but it means that somewhere down the line, God going to bless you because you have expectations. When we pray, we ought to pray with expectation. He says it all the time. If you worry, pray. If you pray, why worry? Everything we do for the Lord, it ought to be done with expectation. This woman had expectations. I'm going to get through whatever obstacles I got to go through because I know something wonderful is about to happen to me. The third reason, I believe, why Jesus asked this question, who touched me? Is because he knew that somebody wanted to walk away with a life-changing experience. This woman touches Jesus. Now keep in mind, for 12 years she has gone through this. 12 years of frustration. 12 years of agony. 12 years of pain. 12 years of suffering. 12 years of being broke. 12 years of not knowing how she's going to pay the bills because the money gone now. 12 years of being used. 12 years of being abused. But she touches Jesus, and in an instant, she just had the experience of a lifetime. Her issue dries up. Her problem dried up. Her failures dried up. And everything bad that had happened in her life before touching Jesus, it was now a non-factor because she just had a life-changing experience. You see, it doesn't matter how long you've been in it. What matters is that Jesus, you touched Jesus, and in doing so, you experience something that changes your life forever. A lot of us wouldn't be where we are right now had we not gone through a life-changing experience with Jesus. But notice what Jesus asked. He said, "Who touched me?" Perceiving that the virtue had gone out of him. But now notice the response of his disciples. You see, they didn't answer Jesus, but they answered Jesus with a question. They're like, "Wait a minute. Why are you asking us? You're the Son of God. You're the Word that was made flesh. Why are you asking us who touched you? Don't you know?" It's amazing. And don't be surprised that when you touch Jesus, that there will be folk around you who will fail to recognize that you've touched Jesus. Oh, y'all didn't get that one. Oh, let me come down and say it again. Don't be surprised that when you touch Jesus, that there will be folk around you. They will be family. They will be friends. They will be co-workers. And sad to say, they'll even be members of the Lord's church. They will fail to recognize, and they will not acknowledge that you have touched Jesus. You see, when you touch Jesus and you're able to put the bottle down, don't be surprised, Dexter, when there's folk out there that act like they have no idea that you've changed your life. When you finally take the needle out of your arm, there will be folk who will not recognize that you did it because you touched Jesus. When you have gotten off the streets, when you have left the game, when you now carry yourself as a young Christian lady with dignity and self-respect, don't be surprised when folk don't recognize it. This woman, she touched Jesus. And instead of celebrating the fact that somebody had touched Jesus, they start complaining, scrutinizing, criticizing. Isn't that how we do as human beings? Person turn their life around, we act like they ain't touched Jesus. Person will stand up in the Lord's church, rededicate their life, and we act like they ain't touched Jesus. Young person. Sometimes we treat our young people like they haven't touched Jesus. And wouldn't you agree, in this world, they need to be touching Jesus as much as they can? The disciple, now keep in mind, they had seen Jesus do all of these other miracles. They saw him raise the dead. They saw him feed the hungry. They saw him call the blind to see. They saw him drive out demons. And now you mean to tell me they will not acknowledge that somebody done touched Jesus? But notice what the woman, the Bible says that the woman now, realizing that she couldn't be hid anymore. And let me tell you something. When you touch Jesus, don't think you can hide under the bed. When you touch Jesus, don't think you can hide in the closet. Because when you touch Jesus, he has a way of working in your life to such a degree that no matter how hard you try, it simply can't be hid. This woman, she touched Jesus, that blood dried up, and now she's put in a position where, let me tell you something, the Lord has a way of doing things so wonderful in our lives, it can't help but to be seen by others. So why is it when the Lord blesses us, why is it when he dries up the issues in our life, we don't want to give him the praise? We don't want to give him the glory. We don't want to acknowledge how good the Lord been to us. this woman now realized she can't hide this anymore. She can't conceal it anymore. And so she comes to Jesus and she acknowledges that she was the one who touched him. And notice what Jesus says. He says, daughter, you be of good comfort, be of good cheer. Your faith had made you whole. Now, the scriptures don't say this, but I'm of the belief that somehow, some way, that there had to be at least somebody else out there in that same crowd who also needed to touch Jesus. Now, scripture don't say it, Fleming. But I'm just of that mindset that there had to be at least somebody else there who also needed to touch Jesus. And maybe for some reason, fear may have been holding them back. Maybe doubt was holding them back. But maybe, just maybe, the fact that this woman had enough faith, she had enough conviction, she had enough trust that Jesus could heal her, the fact that she stepped out on faith, that she demonstrated initiative, that maybe the fact that she touched Jesus, it might motivate somebody else out there in that crowd to touch Jesus. So my message to you is this. Whatever you're struggling with, whatever you're going through in your life, whatever past pain, whatever past problems, whatever past failures you've experienced previously, Jesus can dry them up for you. But you have to be willing to extend yourself. Don't worry about what the other person's doing. Extend yourself. Be filled with an earnest expectation yourself so that you can experience the change of a lifetime. And when you do it, you just might motivate somebody else. You might be the motivating force. You might be the one to give that extra push, that extra encouragement that might move the person sitting next to you that they'll reach out and touch Jesus too. So there you have it. He asked a question, who touched me? He knew that there was somebody who wanted to extend themselves. He knew that there was somebody who had an expectation that something wonderful was about to happen to them, who wanted to have the experience that would change their lives forever. That is why he asked that question. The miracle was wonderful, but the question was even more significant. You might be here this morning, and you want to turn things around in your life. That you want to dry up issues that you're dealing with. And we all got them. Yes, we do. Yours might have dried up yesterday, but just keep on living, baby. You're going to have another one tomorrow. Amen. It's coming. But every time you have an issue, reach out and touch Jesus. And Jesus will dry your issues up. If you're subject to the invitation in any way, you're a member of the body, you stray from the faith, you haven't been willing to extend yourself, you've lost that expectations, and because of that, you're not experiencing the changes in your life that you need, we want you to rededicate your life this morning. Reach out and touch Jesus. Isn't it wonderful? He only, something so simple. But look at how it changed this woman's life forever. Rededicate your life. If you're here and you, by chance, by choice, you're not a member of the body of Christ, I want to ask you to extend yourself this morning. Romans 10 and verse 17, so then faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Bible goes on and tells us that we need to be willing to repent of our sins. Luke 13, 3 through 5. I tell you, nay, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. Hebrews 11 and verse number 6 tells us, for without faith it's impossible to please God. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Confess, Romans 10, verses 9 and 10, with your mouth what your heart believes, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He says, for it's with the heart man believes unto righteousness, but it's with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. We'll bury you in baptism for the remission of sins. 1 Peter 3 and 21, Acts 2 and 38, Romans 6 and verse number 4, Acts 22, verse number 16. Mark chapter 16, verses 15 and 16. Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. You got to extend yourself. Extend yourself beyond what mama did. Extend yourself beyond what granddaddy did. Do it with the expectation that if you touch Jesus through the gospel, he'll make a change in your life that'll stand the test of time. Will you do that? Well, together we stand, together we sing.